the beauty of holiness. Bow down before him, his glory proclaim. With gold of obedience and incense of lowliness, kneel and adore him, the Lord is his name. Low at his feet, lay thy burden of carefulness. High on his heart he will bear it for thee. Comfort thy sorrows and answer thy prayerfulness, guiding thy steps as may best for thee be. Fear not to enter his courts in the slenderness of the poor wealth thou wouldst reckon as thine. Truth in its beauty and love in its tenderness, these are the offerings to lay on his shrine. These though we bring, them in trembling and fearfulness, he will accept for the name that is dear. Mornings of joy give for evenings of tearfulness, trust for our trembling and joy for our fear. You may be seated.
Sister Martha has our sharing for today.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. I'm going to share with you a reading from Lift Him Up, and it's and it reads, and the title of this reading is Jesus' Teaching, Simple but with Authority. And that is the a lesson that we should also embrace, that we can teach simply, and sometimes those simple lessons are the ones that have a bigger impact in our lives, as opposed to trying to teach complex subjects. Usually it comes out of our head, like as soon as it comes in one ear, it goes out the other ear. So it reads like this. He taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. At Capernaum, Jesus dwelt in the intervals of his journey to and fro, and it came to be known as his own city. It was a great thoroughfare of travel. People from many lands passed through the city and tarried for rest in their journeys to and fro. Here, Jesus could meet all nations and all ranks, the rich and great, as well as the poor and lowly, and his lesson would be carried to other countries and into many households. Investigation of the prophecies will be thus excited, attention will be directed to the Savior, and his mission will be brought before the world. Notwithstanding the action of the Sanhedrin against Jesus, the people eagerly awaited the development of his mission. All heaven was astir with interest. Angels were preparing the way for his ministry, moving upon men's heart and drawing them to the Savior. In Capernaum, the noble's man's son, whom Christ had healed, was a witness to his power, and the court official and his household joyfully testified of their faith. When it was known that the teacher himself was among them, the whole city was aroused. Multitudes flocked to his presence. On the Sabbath, the people crowded the synagogue until great numbers had to turn away, unable to find entrance. All who heard the Savior were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. Jesus had nothing to do with the various subjects of dissension among the Jews. It was his work to present the truth. His word shed a flood of light upon the teachings of the patriarchs and prophets, and the scriptures came to men as a new revelation. Never before had his hearers perceived such a depth of meaning in the Word of God. Jesus met the people on their own ground as one who was acquainted with their perplexities. He made truth beautiful by presenting it in the most direct and simple way. His language was pure, refined, and clear as a running stream. His voice was as music to those who had listened to the monotonous tones of the rabbis. But while his teaching was simple, he spoke as one having authority. This characteristic set his teaching in contrast with that of all others. The rabbi spoke with doubt and hesitancy, as if the scriptures might be interpreted to mean one thing or exactly the opposite. The hearers were daily involved in greater uncertainty, but Jesus taught these scriptures as of unquestionable authority. Whatever his subject, it was presented with power, as if his words could not be controverted. In every theme, God was revealed. And this is what, when we speak with others, we also have to be able to speak with authority and with certainty, that the truth that we have come into the knowledge, that it is a truth that we believe in, and not a truth that is like, well, it may or it may not be, because very easily people can see that ambivalence in our lives and in our words and in our deeds. So we have to be able to, when we say that we believe in the health message, that we speak with certainty and we say, yes, I believe in the healing of this remedy because we know it's true. And as others see that we are sure of what it is that we are professing, others will come into the belief. Because as from my reading, when there is ambivalence and when people can easily read that, and that transcends to others, and then others say, like, why am I gonna follow that if they themselves do not believe in it? So when we speak, we have to speak with authority and with the, and like Christ said that he spoke, as simple teachings, and those simple teachings went a long way. So let us be able to strive to be like our master.
It is now time for a children's story. You're the only child today?
No.
No? We're all children, right? This children's story comes from the book of Galatians, chapter 3 and verse 27. It says, therefore, as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Put on Christ. So last week you heard the story of my adventure going to the pool, not coming back in time, being locked out, lost my key, lost my dollar. Everything was a failure, right? And if you remember, I said that my mother made a very important appointment.
No, what?
Yeah, very important appointment which I could not make. And so, what was that appointment? What was that appointment? That appointment that I miss, she used to teach me something, maybe perhaps without knowing. That appointment that I was supposed to go was for me to try on a shirt. See, she wanted to go to the store. And she wanted me to come along to make sure that the shirt fits. And I did not go. But guess what? She went to the store anyway. And she got the shirt. And she said, I got you that shirt you've been talking about. I said, really? I said, yeah, that's nice. You know, I've been talking about this shirt. It used to come in blue, white, red. Did it come in yellow? I wouldn't even be surprised if it came in yellow. But it came in different colors. And what was special about this shirt, right? was that on the left side it had an alligator. Uh-huh. Anybody remember that?
Yes.
A shirt with an alligator? And you know, I can just envision myself putting on that shirt, going to school, right? Maybe I put some shades on too. Taking the long way to the bathroom. Can you envision that?
No.
No? That's okay, because I bought one. I bought a shirt. This is the shirt. Can you envision it now? With me in shades, walking down the hallway, down the street. Looks cool, right? And what does it have? Yes, what does it have? The alligator. So this is the shirt I wanted. Everybody had one. This one is in blue, but they came in red, yellow, white, different sizes. And it felt good. This one is, let me see. Designed in France, made in Peru. Yeah. At least it's not China, right? So she says, come to the room. I have the shirt for you. So I went into the room, and after I hanged up my wet socks, I saw the shirt there on the bed. And the room was special because it had a long mirror, right? So I could put on the shirt and look at myself. So I said, okay, I put on the shirt. Oh, and I stood in front of the mirror, and I looked at the shirt. You know, when you're not sure, like, you want to see something, and you go, like, you know, you go like that. You ever done that? When you can't believe what you're seeing, or you're trying to visualize a little bit better, you go like that, and you look, and I said to myself, something is not right. And I saw a little bit close to my shirt, and there was something wrong with the logo. I go like this. And I opened my eyes, and I could not believe what I saw. It wasn't an alligator. It was a turtle. I said to myself, it's a turtle, the same turtle like in the wax. You know the car wax? The turtle wax? I said, it's a turtle. And then I started noticing other things. It had a line, like right here. And then right here in the collar had a little, like a blue. I said, oh, man, I can't believe this. Dun, 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 dun. It is a knockoff of the shirt that I wanted. I was horrified. But my mother was there. And I had the shirt on. And I knew it wasn't the shirt. It had a turtle on it. I didn't want her to make her feel bad. I mean, we were so poor. She worked hard. She put a sweat, right? Her blood, her tears went into this shirt. She said, you could wear it for the first day of school. I said to myself, wow, what am I going to do now? First weekend of school, and you know, when school starts, as always, you get days off, right? It's only 3 days, so I pulled it off. The first week went, and you put on the shirt. And on the weekend, she said, you gonna wear your shirt? I said, I can't hold it off no more. I said, yeah, I'll wear the shirt. Again, this was my mother, right? I put that shirt at the end of the rotation. But sooner or later, that shirt came up. And I put it on. And I went to school. Put it on. Put on my jeans. And there I am with my shirt. It was in red with a turtle. And I tell you, that turtle could have been on my head. Because I felt it was just so big, you know, everybody could see it. And so I went to school, and I went to my friends, and they didn't say anything. My friends didn't say anything. But I knew they were looking at my turtle. And the day went on, until, you know, that guy comes in school with all the pens in his pocket, and he tells me, why didn't you get the one with the alligator? do you have a turtle in your shirt? I said, oh, I think it's a crocodile. I think it's a tortoise, not a turtle. I said, oh, I don't know. All I know is not the one I wanted. But this is what fashion does to us, doesn't it? It makes us preoccupied with worrying what everybody else is worrying. You know, fashion is something else, isn't it? One moment, alligator. The next moment, the turtle. But you don't want the turtle because everybody has the alligator. But then you see other people who has the same shirt you do. So then you say, oh, then this must be okay. Now everybody has the turtle. I started seeing in my life that fashion is crazy. One moment, they make fun of you because your socks are down, so you pull them up. So they make fun of you, your socks are up, so you put them back down. Another age, the bottoms are wide. They're bell bottoms. And then it's okay for a time. And then they make fun of you. So what you do, you put it really tight. And then you see girls wearing pants like that, right? One moment, tattoos are fashionable, now they're not. I remember if your pants were too high, they would make fun of you. You have high waters, right? So you put your pants down. And guess what I saw a couple years ago in the bus stop? A guy walking with high waters in a suit. I said, oh, wow. I said, Martha, why is it people wearing high waters? Oh, because, you know, that's the style now. And I could go on and on. You know, I noticed that it didn't matter what shirt I wore. My friends were still my friends. And after a while, they really didn't care what I had. You see, it was all in my mind. You have a nice shirt on, right? But would it matter if you had another shirt on? Not really. Your friends would still be your friends, right? You know, as long as the quality of your clothes are good, right? And they're modest, you can wear them. But you know what? Christ has something for us to wear. It's not designed in Italy, or made in Peru or China, but it's made in the looms of heaven. And it costs more than blood, sweat, and tears. It cost him his life. And you know what? That garment that he has, it could be ours, if we want it. The Bible says that it will never go out of style. It will last for eternity. So all we need is one. But the problem is it doesn't fit. It doesn't fit. You know why? Because we have on another garment. So in order for us to take the garment from heaven, we have to take off the old garment. Just like you cannot wear another shirt on top of that shirt, can you? That's kind of silly, right? You have to take off that shirt and put on another shirt, right? That's the same way we have to do, or the same thing we have to do when we put on the garment of Christ. If we want to put on Christ, we have to take off the old garment of the world. And then that garment will fit. But many of us will not want that garment because you know why? Everybody else may not have the same garment. Do you want to be the only one with the garment of God? Everybody making fun of you? You know that happens, right? Until it goes out of style and trouble comes. And then what you have goes in style, right? That's why we have to stick with our beliefs. Because sooner or later, trouble is going to come. And situations are going to arise in which God is going to have you stand up with your garment and live his word. So let us not be preoccupied with this thing called fashion. We do have to look sort of like everybody else, right? We don't want to be walking around with a big thing on our head like they used to do in the 1800s. You know, makes us look like we have a hammer on our head, right? But we need to We cannot be a distraction to people. Like, I don't, it doesn't matter to me if I have a tie or not. But I have it on because a lot of people wear the tie, and it helps me look approachable, right? And that's what matters to me. Again, I say, let us put on the heavenly garment. Let us put on Christ. Our Heavenly Father has done a lot for us. We don't need to be ashamed of what the garments He gives to us, right? Just like the garments you have now, your mother bought them. And she worked hard. She worked hard for it, right? Okay, so we're happy with the garments that they give to us. But we also have to be happy with the garments that Christ gives to us, which is Himself. And we have to put Him on us. So we can focus on being a blessing to other people. So let us put on the garment of Christ, which is holiness, right? Obedience, not only to our parents, but especially to God. Are you happy with your garments right now? You look pretty nice, right? You like your garments? You like your pants? I like your shirt, right? And they look nice. But let us not forget that there are other garments that comes from heaven that we need to put on. At this time, we're going to have our tithes and offerings collected by Brother Ernesto. And we collect these tithes and offerings because it is to supplement or to support the God's people. He had reserved it to Himself to be employed for religious purposes, and it is holy. And it goes on to say that nothing less than this has been accepted in any dispensation. At this time, Brother Ernesto will collect our tithes and offering. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful and thankful for the opportunity this week that we've had to come in contact with family members and spend time with them, get to know them better. We're so grateful for the things that you've done for us this year and throughout our lives and how you brought us from darkness into light. We ask the Heavenly Father that our minds be at ease and our hearts be a cheer as we give to thy economy, that we are partakers of this a special system in which you have set up for the employment of thy people and for furthering the gospel of the Lord to the poor. We're grateful for all that we can do, not only in material possessions, but also in influence and our talents and our time. We ask thee, Lord, that you may multiply these gifts and bless them for the glorification of thy kingdom. In Christ I pray. Amen. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. This is one of the special chapters in hymns, in Psalms, I rather say, 136, which should continue on to say that God's mercy endures forever, and God's mercy endures forever, and to continue on to say that. And we're so grateful to be here worshiping. Are there any prayer requests? Yes. Brother Ness. Okay. Okay. Very good.
I have a cousin dealing with the cancer.
Okay. Cancer. Very difficult, right? Okay. We pray for members who are not here, right? Oh, yes, this is the first time you saw him. He came 2 weeks ago, right? 2 weeks from Colorado. Interesting, right? Yes, though.
Her request for a friend of mine whose wife is dealing with some issues, and she's in the hospital at the moment. She seems to be recovering somewhat. So.
His mom, your friend's mom.
Yeah, my friend's, his wife.
Oh, his wife, sorry. Okay.
Yeah, I actually visit at times and play music, do music therapy.
Okay. Very good. We do what we can, right? Yes.
For the families that are represented in here and those are missing members, our family in the whole.
Okay. Amen. And so Heather's here. We see Heather sometimes, right? Once a year, twice a year. So it's a good thing. Okay, right, they came. Okay, at this time we're going to kneel and sing hymn number 671.
Now, dear Lord, as we pray, take our hearts and minds far away from the press of the world all around, to your throne where grace does abound. May our lives be transformed by your love. May our souls be refreshed from above. At this moment, let people everywhere join us now as we come to you in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name, dear Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we're grateful for us to have this opportunity to communicate with you. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that you have promised to us that if we cry out to you, our desires and our wants, that you will hear us and be able to deliver thy blessings according to thy word and our faith. We thank you, dear Lord, for being a powerful God, for there's nothing on this earth more powerful than prayer. We thank you, dear Lord, for the petitions that were made public, but I also pray, dear Lord, for those secret petitions that were not said. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that there are things that we need, and you are aware of these things. So let us not lose hope, but continue to go to you for all our wants and needs. We ask the Heavenly Father for those petitions that were said, for Cheryl's son, who's going to start a employment. We know, the Heavenly Father, that you have made us to work, and it is a good thing for us to work. Let us pray for this young man, that whatever he does, may he do it with all his strength and in his hands, and may his heart be in the right place, dear Lord. And we ask, dear Lord, that we also pray for Cheryl. We met her before, and we ask that one day that we can see her again. We also pray, dear Heavenly Father, for an individual, Alamsa mentioned, is suffering from cancer. This is a very difficult disease to treat. Many people do not survive it, but there are some, dear Heavenly Father, that do get the victory, and they do survive. And we pray that this individual may be one of them. We also pray for the two other son that alums I got to see. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that the children are a blessing, and may we always stay faithful to you in raising them. We also pray for the members that are not here. We pray that wherever they are, they could be online, that they may be blessed. We also pray, dear Lord, for those people online. Let us not forget them who are participating and contributing to building what we're doing here as a ministry, dear Lord, based upon your foundation. We pray for them. We also pray, dear Heavenly Father, for Derek's son's wife, who at this time is in the hospital, but she is healing. And we pray, dear Lord, that she may be led to your word, dear Lord. We know that physically we can be sick, but dear Heavenly Father, also our minds need to be healed. And sometimes we have minds that go astray from your word, but we ask, dear Lord, that we all may be healed physically, but also mentally. We also pray for the families that are here, that are together. Heather's here with her family and reunited to the things that she's familiar with. And it is good for us to spend time together, to be united as friends and family. And this time in the year gives us the opportunity to do so. So we're grateful for that. We ask, dear Lord, that traveling mercies may be with Heather as she goes back, whenever she goes back, and any of us who is traveling to visit the sick or family members. We thank you, dear Lord, for this time that we set aside things of the world, dear Lord, to hear your word. And you have promised us that we're obedient, that you will give us that blessings. We ask at this time prayer for our pastor, Lloyd Grubbs, as he breaks the bread of life, dear Lord. We thank you for your word. And we ask, dear Lord, at this time that our hearts may be open to it. In Christ I pray. Amen.
So Lord, hear our prayers, O Lord, incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace.
Let us go to a scripture. It is found in 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to read two verses, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. It says in verse 3 of 2 Peter chapter 1, according as his divine power hath given unto us, unto us, all things that pertaineth unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust.
Sabbath to everyone again. Welcome again to worship here. And just want to congratulate again Heather for doing 6 years, right? 6 solid years. And it went by fast or slow?
Fast.
All right, that's what it is. 5 years can't go by so fast. She did 6. So that's good. So congratulations for completing your course in, pardon me for forgetting which branch of the military. The Air Force, right, the Air Force. So congratulations again, 6 years, and it went by fast, you say. So that's a good thing. If it went by slow, that would be a bad thing. So praise the Lord and welcome again. So God bless again to everyone. Our topic for this morning here is a continuation of where we were last week. So I'm talking about spirituality, And I've been talking about that as we go towards the end of the year. Very important to understand some things about why it's important to be spiritual. Important. And we're going to be comparing spirituality or being spiritual in comparison to being carnal. So our topic is the power of being spiritual over being carnal. The power of being spiritual over being carnal. Very important topic. And I pray that this may be a blessing to you as we expand our understanding of God and the spiritual world. So let us pray again. Thank you, Lord, again for your love towards us. We invite thy presence to be with here again. We invite thy spirit to be in our hearts. And we pray that, dear Lord, you may give us the ability to be concentrated and focused and to also be receptive to thy leading. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So the power of being spiritual over being carnal. What is it about being carnally minded that results in death? Well, the Bible simply states here, and this is part of what I'm going to be talking about mainly. In Romans 8, verse 6, it says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." So there's something about a carnal mind that it results in death, but the opposite of a spiritual mind, which is the power of the spiritual mind, which really answers the topic, it gives life and it gives peace. So one has some life and then one has some peace in one's soul. It's good to have peace, amen? All right, and so this is really the mindset. So we're really going to be probing that question. What is it about this mindset that gives us, that makes it that we run into some serious problems? Now, what is it about the carnal mind that causes us not to be able to keep the Ten Commandments? There's something about the carnal mind that causes us not, you know, that we can't keep the Ten Commandments. Now, this evening for our closing talk, we're going to just kind of spend some time looking at the Ten Commandments, and we're going to blow this question up much more. So I'm just throwing it here, but in the evening, I'm going to spend the time in the Ten Commandments and analyze it from what we studied this morning or this afternoon here as what is it. So sometime about 3:45, we'll reconvene again for the evening presentation, and we're going to look at the Ten Commandments, and we're going to go into a deeper answering of this question. Now, Romans 7, verse 14, it says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I'm carnal, sold under sin." So the law is spiritual. Now, when you read the law, it says, "Thou shalt not." You know, it says, "I just have one God." And he's saying that's spiritual. Now, rules, you would say, if it says, "Don't drive down the road beyond 65 miles per hour," you wouldn't say that's spiritual. That's just a rule that's governed probably what your car can take and what you can react to going around the corner at a certain mile per hour. It's just practical. But the Bible says, "Thou shalt not kill." Why is that spiritual? So we're going to look at that this morning, and then we're going to go more into that later on, especially later on. So again, it says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, soul, and sin." So it tells us that something about us as human beings, that we're different. We're not spiritual, we're carnal. Yet, as I covered last week, we were created to be spiritual beings. We're created in the image of God. The Bible says God is a spirit. So we were created to be like God, but somehow we are carnal. Well, look at that. Now, what happened when a person is given over to carnality? Now, I might clarify the word carnality to mean this. As I always say, normally they say soul food. Soul food is probably one of the best food that you express the meaning to me, at least in my mind, of what carnality is. Soul food is just irrational food. There's no intellectual assent to the food. You don't eat the food because it's going to make you healthier. You don't eat that type of food because it's going to make you have more nutrients. You're not going to get younger eating the food. It just has to do with the taste and the stomach. It's nice, heavy, filled with fat, filled with oil. The worst type of food, the worst part of the animal is normally what you say is soul food. It's going to be some gravy in it. It's going to be some cheese in there, a lot of oil. It's just food that's going to make you get thick. Right? Both in your mind and in your body. So it is carnal. It just deals with the flesh. It doesn't deal with the intellectual or the higher powers of the mind. You don't reason and eat it in a reasonable way. You just eat the food because it's good. So what happened to a person that they're given over to carnality? Romans chapter 7 verse 5 states that, "For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto what? death. So you see a person lying in the casket. And literally, they die. You say, why did they die? What? They say, well, they die of some disease. How did they get that disease? Well, they picked that disease up from the prostitutes. Then did they know that the prostitutes would give them disease? Yes, but they couldn't stop themselves. Why is it they couldn't stop themselves? Because of the carnal mind. The carnal mind is only focused on what the flesh wants. And if you tell a person, the prostitutes will make you the happiest person in the world, the person like, but you'll die of diseases, the person like happiness, and they go die of diseases. That's how life is. The carnal flesh will just take whatever makes it happy irrationally. Makes no sense. And that's the reality of the carnal mind. More on that later. Now, what happens when a person is given over to carnality? Again, we read in Romans chapter 6, and we're going to read verse 12 through 16, I think that said here. It says here, Romans chapter 6, verse 12 says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. So sin can reign. What does it mean when somebody's in reigning? They're in power. That's the thing that's number one. So a person who now, another example would be a person who's an alcoholic. What's reigning in their life? Is it their job? Is it their family? Is it the health of their body? Is it their social status in life? Is it anything else but the alcohol? It's the alcohol. But really what's reigning is the feeling of wanting to be high. Yes. You know, because alcohol don't taste good. So again, and it's harsh. If you ever had overproof rum, that thing feel like you're drinking, you know, gas, you know, kerosene, petroleum. And literally, guess what they use overproof for? Petroleum, because it's ethanol. It's ethanol. It's used in your car. And something that's used in your car to drive you down the road at even 65 miles per hour, you can drink that, and it feels like you're drinking petroleum coming down your throat. But why? But it doesn't make any sense. But why the person do it? Because the end result is they're gonna feel good. Talk more. So look at that. It says reign because of lust. Lust is what? It's like a desire, and I want to satisfy my desire. My desire and all of our desire, we all want to get to the same place. We all want to be happy. Everybody wants to be happy. Everybody has the same desires. But there's something now about this concept of carnal mind that creates the problem. Verse 13 says, neither yield yourself, your members, as instrument of unrighteousness. So you have a brain and you have a hand, and you can get a gun or a knife, you can rob a bank. You don't want to rob the bank. You don't have anything personal against the bank tellers that you're willing to shoot them to get the money. Nothing personal. You still shoot them, but you don't really want to do it. You don't know these people. You have nothing against them. But I want the money and the results that the money can buy. So I'll hurt the bank teller to get the money. So the Bible said, don't yield yourself like that. But the end result, when the carnal mind is at work, it will cause us to yield ourselves to become instrument of unrighteousness. But yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instrument of righteousness unto God. Verse 14 says, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Normally, this law we're talking about is a law of sin that works in the body. So you're not under this, because if you're under this, well, the end result is not going to be good. Because there is a law that's governing a person that because the mind or the body tell them, do it, do it, do it, they'll do it to their own hurt and end up dying. And you're saying to them, just give up the M&Ms, just give up the M&Ms. And the person is like, yeah, but the M&Ms make me feel good. And if I feel good, I'm going to do it. And he said, but this is irrational. What you doing? You're going to kill yourself because of the M&Ms. And the person is like, no, but the M&Ms let me feel good. I prefer to die on the M&Ms. Verse 15 says, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? God forbid, because sin is a problem. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourself servant to be, his servant ye are to whom you obey, whether sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. So obedience causes you to do right. Sin causes you to die. Sin causes you to die. I'm sure you've seen it where you're pleading with a person, praying for a person, and you're saying to them, just give up the fried chicken. Give up the fried chicken. And you watch the doctor take an axe and chop off their big toe, because normally the big toe goes first. And you're pleading to them, please give up the fried chicken, give it up. And they'll be like, but the fried chicken make me feel good. And then the doctor go and chop some more toes off. And you're like, please. And you're like, what's wrong with this person? Why can't they just give up the fried chicken? Save your toes. Next thing you know, the doctor chop the foot off at the knee. So I don't know what you call it, leg, sorry. Chop the leg off at the knee. No. Yes. And it chopped the leg off, and the person still won't give up the fried chicken. No. Why? Because there's something about the carnality that it governs, it reigns, and it reigns to the person dead. And unless that mindset is broken, then the person will destroy himself. Being dead, made free from sin, yea, became the servants of righteousness. So this is what we need to do, become the servants of righteousness. So how did we get into, get sold into this carnal focused lifestyle? How did this happen? How did this happen? How did we get sold into this carnal focused lifestyle where I will hurt myself just to make myself be happy? What happened? And as human beings, everybody's like this. None of us are immune from this. This is what we are born with. This is a programming we are born with, and we are nurtured into this way. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 through 6 verse, and then after that, we're going to read verse 7. So Genesis chapter 3, turn with me, and I want you to focus on this here, understand how we got here, because somebody say, Lloyd, what you're saying here is for some people, it's for everybody. Everybody has this sin. It's everybody has this plague, so to speak, or this disease. We're born with a disease. And it came from here, Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 through 6. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, at God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden. So here we believe that says a possession, what we call in modern day time, demon possession is happening to the serpent. I'm not going to go and explain all of that. And the serpent said to the woman, you cannot eat of this tree. Now the tree in the garden, there was two trees in the garden, the tree of life and the tree of good and evil, or tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you could not eat of it. But in the garden, there was many, 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 many trees. But there was this one tree that you could not eat of it. It was forbidden. And today, so is life. If you tell the average person who are carnal now, don't do this. It's like you're wasting your time. They're going to do the opposite. So, verse 2. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye what? Die. So remember, sin caused death, and the end result of living a carnal life is death, which is the end result of eating from a tree in this situation here. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, which is, as we understand, is a convoluted statement. So here, the serpent says, no, you won't die if you eat of it. And this here formed the basis of our thinking. You won't die. You can eat of something that is bad for you, and guess what happened? You won't die. Is this true? Can you eat of things that are bad for you that ultimately will kill you, and you won't die? Yes. Ultimately, you will die, but not right away. You see, if you take poison, you don't always have to die, especially if the poison is diluted. Have you ever heard this principle that people says, dilution is the solution for pollution? Ever heard that? Dilution is the solution for pollution. That means if you have something that is toxic, you can dilute it down. Everybody do it. We all drink, if we drink public water. Public water is basically dilution, which is a solution for pollution, which is basically chlorine poured into your water and give it to you, and you drink the chlorine. It will kill the bacteria, but it won't kill you because you're larger than the bacteria, right? And so that's, but if you drink the chlorine, it's, if you ever see chlorine being distributed by a truck, you see at the back of it, skull and bones, you know, the skull, right? It's telling you, that's if you, and it says corrosive, if you drink that, you just melt inside, all right? But if you dilute it, it diluted out, so it's not as toxic to you. It's toxic to the bacteria. But I'm not one that really believes that, because you can dilute something down and kill you long term. Coffee will kill you if about 120 cups one time. But if you dilute it down and take a cup every day for 100 and something days, it won't do anything to you immediately. But are you dying?
Yes,
you're dying. And that's the trick with sin. Now, we're going to get there in a second. And that's the trick with sin and the carnal mind. The carnal mind says, I don't have to do that because I can still live. I won't die. That's what the carnal mind says. And I can be happy. I'm going to get there in a second. So the serpent says, you shall surely die. And the woman says, wow, what a thought. That blows my mind. You mean I can eat it and not die? Think about that. God says, you shall surely die. And the devil says, nope, you shall not die. And now the woman is in a bind. Who to believe? Because God says, die. And the devil says, you won't die. So, verse 5. For God doth know that in the day, right, that you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be what? Open. And you shall be as what? Gods. And knowing good and evil. So you shall be of gods, knowing good and evil. So in the day that you eat it, you shall not die. You tell a child, don't do it, and the child do it, and nothing happened. And they say, like, why did they tell me not to do it? They're trying to keep me from something that is good for me. And now I got them. I'm one upon them now. I got them. So verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for what? Food. Now she saw. Now before Satan said, you shall not surely die, she was looking at the tree, it was not good for food. Right? Satan says, you won't die. She looked at the tree and she say, oh, that's good for food. Her mindset had changed. So she looked at it and said, it's good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes. Before she looked at it, that thing was, you know, horrible. Not good. Now she look at it, she says, like, man, that thing looks good. And a tree to be desired to make one what? Wise. She took the fruit thereof. All that changed is not the tree, but is her mindset. The moment the mindset changed, this is the source of carnality. I'm going to explain in a second. This is the source of carnality. This is why we're carnal. Amen. It's our mindset change towards sin and doing wrong. It's not sin and doing wrong is good. It's our mindset looking at it, we assume it's good. So notice, therefore, she did eat and she gave also to her husband with her. And he what? He did eat. Because guess what she says? Hey, come over here. This is good food. Come over here. It's not an acquired taste. Don't worry about it. It's good. Eat it. Right? And you're like, really? How many times you've eaten stuff not because you even thought it was even food? It's because the Indians thought it was food. Indians from India. There's things that the Indians from India eat that I was like, wow, it blows your mind. Because they make all kinds of food. And you look at it and I say, that's not food. And they say, oh, no, it's food. Try it. Oh, man, it tastes good. With some curry. Great. Great. Right? You never think it's food. So here's what happened. This is the carnal mind. The carnal mind, this is the mindset that creates the carnal mind. The carnal minded, I can get good results by disobedience or from disobedience. The spiritual minded, I can get good results by obedience. Again, carnal mind, I can get good results by disobedience. Spiritual mind, I can get good results from disobedience. Adam and Eve, before they sin, sorry, by obedience. Adam and Eve, before they sinned, they were spiritual minded. You can only get good results by obedience. The moment she got tricked into this mindset, I can get good results from disobedience. That's what the devil was saying to her. You can get what you want by doing the wrong thing. And this day, this is our plague of society. And we all are touched by this disease. I can get good results by doing wrong. I don't have to do the right thing to get good results. And the end result is you can, so to speak, get good results by doing wrong. You can get positive results by doing wrong. And so here, I'm going to give you some example. So my flesh will temporarily confirm the truth that my carnal mind, the truth of my carnal mind. My flesh will temporarily confirm the truth of my carnal mind. My flesh will tell me, you got the good results and you did wrong. And guess what happens when you do it? You don't die. So you'll do it again. So in Genesis chapter 3, verse 7, it says, and the eyes of both of them were what?
Open
because they see a new reality. Is it a new reality? The reality that Adam and Eve have before the sin is that every time they wanted good, they had to do good. They had to be obedient. And good always follow. But here was the first time they did wrong, bad didn't follow, and they had a good result. Did the fruit taste good?
Yes.
Did the fruit open their eyes?
Yes.
Did they go through a new psychic experience, psychedelic experience?
Yes.
Yes. And guess what happened? They didn't. Did they die in a day?
No.
Bam! God was proven wrong.
Yes.
You see that?
Yes.
The devil says, in the day you eat it, God knows you what? You shall not surely die, right? And they ate it. And guess what happened? He was right. God was wrong. You didn't die. And you go there now and ask any sinner, say, if you do wrong, will you die? And they tell you, nope, I can do wrong and get good results. There's no person on this earth that don't believe the same way the devil just said. You can do wrong and you can get positive results. And that's the problem with the carnal mind. You will always do wrong and always get positive results. Because you're not going to die immediately. And the other thing there is that you're going to become like what? Gods. Because you're not like gods. You know good and evil and you're not affected. And you see people today destroying themselves because they're getting positive results from their wrong actions. But before sin, Adam and Eve did right and they got right. After sin, they did right and they got good. And they're surely living. I'm alive. Ain't nothing wrong with me. You go to people and talk and say, why don't you follow Jesus? Why don't you do the right thing? I'm good. I'm good. I don't need that. Because guess what happened? I'm alive. You see, I'm alive. You alive? Me alive? What's the problem? I'm not dead. This thing ain't killing me. But look, my flesh will temporarily confirm the truth, which is a lie, of my carnal mind, that I can get good results from doing wrong. So, and the eyes of them were both open. I always view verse 7 as like taking drugs. You say to a person, hey, why don't you just stop talking the way you're talking and living the way you're living, and you won't be depressed anymore. And the person said, no, I can smoke some weed, I can take some cocaine, and I'll be high. All my troubles just go away, they just fly. Mm-hmm. My troubles fly away. So why are you telling me that say I need to live right to feel happy? I don't need to live right to feel happy because guess what happened? Drugs can make me feel happy. Does this work? Yes. Yes.
Yes, sir.
No. Yes, sir. No. Alcohol too? You never have to live right to be high in this life. You can't take drugs. You can drink alcohol. And you'll be happy. And you won't die. So that's why the person keep doing it, because guess what happened? Instead of changing their life and follow the Lord and do obedience and get the right benefit, they say, I don't have to be obedient. All I have to do is drink the alcohol and my words just fly away. My wife started to scream at me. I just smoke some weed and all the screaming just disappear. Like, what happened there? I feel so good. I don't know what you're talking about. I can take it. You can hit me hard and I won't feel the pain. Because guess what happened? I'm numb. And so they knew that they were naked and they saw fig leaf, they become inventors. I'm like God, because God, what God does, God is a creator. I become creative and I get to get rid of my problem. So I don't need God because I can't fix my own problem. If I go naked, I just get some clothes and I put on the clothes. I'm good. So they saw fig leaf and they made themselves aprons. So here's some practical example of how this works. Now, I can attract with certain things, right? Like, I can attract somebody with a car. So I'm a young guy, I get a nice car, I know all the girls are going to be attracted to me. Some of the girls are attracted to me, and I'm driving a nice sports car, bam, I get the girl. I don't have to be a nice person. I don't have to be attracted myself. I just need that car because that car is going to catch the girl. She's going to want to go in the back seat or the front seat or whatever seat she wants. But what happened now? What did I attract the girl with? The car. No, I have a problem in my hand. But I got good results. But I have a problem in my hand now because guess what happened? She attracted to the car. And if next year I can't buy a new one, I'm going to lose that girl. So now I have a headache on my hand. But at the moment, I don't have a headache really because I have a temporarily good solution. I attract a guy with a dress. I know when I walk down the road and I dress in a certain way, that guy is going to blow his mind. So guess what happened now? He's attracted to that dress. I mean, to my dress. But the thing is now I have to keep producing that for him. And if I can't keep producing that for him, I'm going to have a headache because that guy look at me and say, that's a sexual being. And if I can't keep delivering, that guy's going to walk. So now I'm stuck in a bind because temporarily, my carnality told me I can get certain results from certain behavior. So I'm going to have to, now I'm stuck in that behavior because I know if I do this, bam, I'm going to get results. And if I keep getting the results, I'm going to keep doing it. Because I can do wrong and get positive results. Now the example of this is attract to Christ with certain type of music and preaching our message. So we can do church and we can make our music sound just like the secular music. Just the music. Not the music that make you do like this. The music make right here just keep going round and round. Right? It's just like, it's not my brain. It doesn't affect my brain. It just affect right here below the waist. And I could just come, you come to church and you just feel good from here downwards. And guess what? I'm going to pack the church. But now I'm stuck because one day I need to tell him I need to find Jesus and repent. And I can't tell you all that. Because you came with the wrong attraction. And I realized I can get positive results by doing the wrong thing over and over again. And that's what drives our thinking. Trying to get to a certain end result, which is always to do with happiness, success, but the wrong thing. Same thing with preaching. I can preach and make a lot of noise and know that says most people on the average, they're emotional and they want to get emotional driven. And I don't want to affect your thinking. I just want to affect your emotions. You cry, you feel like, oh, I just want to give my life to Jesus. And then you just continue going out there and sinning. You never have to think about what it is like to accept Christ. And the end results are going to be terrible. But the attraction gives me some temporary result. I know I can do wrong and get positive results. Same thing with the message. I can preach a prosperity gospel. So I go to a church in the poorest neighborhoods across America, or even the richest neighborhoods. And I tell people, I say, you can just live for money and for pride and for pleasure, and you can go to heaven. You don't have to give up nothing. And guess what happened? People buy it all day long. Because that's the message they want to hear. People want to hear, I'm going to be the greatest. And I can get positive results and never have to do the right thing. And I can do it over and over again, it'll be work. And so I think, you know, the members in the church realize, they're not really accepting no gospel. And they're not living no righteous life. And they fall out. But new people come. New people are fooled by the preaching. And they come and they give me the money. I can't keep doing that. Another example of it is I can get a wife through adultery. Can I get a wife through adultery?
Yes.
Yeah. Can get a wife through adultery. Get a wife through adultery. And now I have that wife. She broke up her marriage. She come over here and she joined me. Now I have a problem on my hand. Because now I'm looking at that wife and thinking, if she broke up her marriage and left her husband for me, could she leave me for another guy? So now I have a headache of mine. But at the moment, I have her. I have her. She might. But now I have a headache on my hand. Because I'm thinking somebody could do the same thing that I just did to her husband. So now I can't sleep at night. And I'm watching every time. Now I have to put something on her car to track wherever she go. Because I don't trust her and I need to hire an investigator to watch her. Because I know she's going to do this to me. But remember now, the carnal mind is I can get good results by doing wrong. I don't have to be obedient. I don't have to go find my own wife. I can steal somebody's wife. And this is why this thing never stops. Because again, that's what the Bible says, the commandment of the Lord is spiritual. It's not carnal. It's not focused on doing wrong. It's focused on doing right. And the commandment is from God. And God, who sees the end from the beginning, knows that says, you got to keep this. If you want good results, you can't be a disobedient person. If you want good results, you got to do the right thing. I can get high using drugs and alcohol. Is that true? I mentioned that earlier. So I won't spend too much time on this. I can get high by using drugs and alcohol. Somebody said to me, said, Lloyd, stop lying. You're too lying. And you keep have to be covering your tracks. And you keep getting caught, and people keep cursing you out for your lying self or your lying ways. And people keep breaking relationships with you because you lie. And I can say, yeah, but I can lie and get more friends. So now I know that, you know, it's, you know, when they talk about somebody, like a person have a taste, like the animal, or if they attack a human being, they have to kill the animal. You know why? Because they have a taste now. Now, there's a problem in their mind. And that's the problem with sin, because we know we can get good results, we keep doing it. The police pull you over, just start crying. Just start crying. Oh, I didn't know. Oh, I'm so sorry. What's, eh? Oh, my, start telling like your family members, next you know, somebody calls you and say, your mother is actually dead. All right? So you keep lying, and you know, I can get results from lying. And I can get positive results. So now you're like an animal that needs to be put down. Because now you're sick, because you figure it out. So you see a young girl and you like her. And you want to get with her, but you can't get with her probably. If you think to yourself, if you tell her the truth, she won't get with you. So you go whisper in her ears, right? And all of a sudden she's like, really, I like you. All lies. And you're just like, wow, that's great. So now, like especially teenage boys, you have to watch them. Because they're going to figure out that they can lie to female and get results. It works. They can tell him a whole bunch of stuff. Oh, don't worry about it. I'll send your kids to private school. Right? I'll send your kids to the Adventist school, right? Just get with me. Come with me. I'll take care of your kids. And next thing you know, the girl is with you. You realize, wow, if I didn't tell her that lie, oh, she wouldn't come with me. So now I have a bad habit now, because now I'm going to start telling all of them lies. And they're going to believe me and they're going to come with me. But the end result is going to be now I'm going to have to produce and deliver. And I can't deliver because the whole thing was a big lie. And they're going to find me out. So no, I keep lying. I keep lying. And I have to keep going to more people and more lying. Because they're going to find out I'm broke. And the car is actually my friend's car. It's not my car. And all that stuff. Observe Sunday as my Sabbath because it is convenient and everybody is doing it. How about that? Observing Sunday as the Sabbath. I can be spiritual, but I have to be obedient. That's what Sunday worship is. I can keep a day holy, but I have to keep the day that God tells me to be holy. That's why the Ten Commandments is spiritual. And I'm carnal. The whole reason is not because a religious folk who are spiritual. That's why we have Sunday. It's because people are carnal. That's why we have Sunday worship. Because Sunday worship has nothing to do with the Bible. It's had to do with people who say, oh, well, it's more convenient to go to church on Sunday. And then some people, if you're Muslim, go to church on Friday. Anything else but doing what God said to do. Because I want to have spirituality and I want to get the benefits of being a Christian and go to church. But I don't want to do it the way God wants me to do it. Again, another quick example here is stealing. I can go and I can rob a bank and get a whole year's pay. I don't have to work. I don't have to put in the hard labor. So the person will steal and do all kind of stuff like that because they're going to get the results, but they do not have to do the right thing. The carnal mind is focused on getting results without doing the right thing. Obedience is not their focus. The only focus is I want to get results. And I'll do it anyway. Before sin, Adam and Eve would do always the right thing to get the right result. After sin, they have learned a bad behavior. And it's passed on to us. We all struggle with this. That I know I can cut corners. I know I can lie. I can steal. I can do all these things. And I can get positive results. But long term, what happened? It always backfires. Because it leads to debt. Because sooner or later, we get caught into a habit or an addiction and we can't break loose of it. And now, there goes the end of our lives. There I can receive the Holy Spirit, or I can receive spirituous liquor, or I can receive marijuana. I can get the results of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to turn with my Bible here. And do pardon me, I leave my Bible here a little bit. I'm going to turn with me. I just put this note here because I wanted to turn quickly to my Bible. So in Galatians chapter 5, I'm going to show you how this works. See, we all want the Spirit, the results of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit. But the problem is that we often don't want it the way. So somebody will go to the liquor store, and the liquor store sells spirit, right? They sell spiritus liquor. And we go to the liquor store and we go get some spiritus liquor, and we want the end result of what it would be to have the true spirit, not the false spirit. And in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, it says here, for the fruit of the spirit, the end result of the spirit. Remember, somebody drinking the alcohol, they don't want the taste of the alcohol. They just want the results, right? It's results driven,
yes, sir.
Right? So again, the fruit of the spirit is love. Is a person when they drink alcohol more loving? Yeah, they're more loving. As a matter of fact, there are certain drugs you can take, like Adderall, and certain things, certain drugs like that, that will make you be more friendly. More friendly. That's right. More friendly. Each of the drugs, that's what they do. They fix a problem. So whatever problem you're having, it can fix it. So here it says love. How about joy? The person becomes the life of the party. But in their life without the drugs, they're not the life of the party. But they desire to be the life of the party. So they go to the Holy Spirit now to become the life of the party and receive of the Spirit by accepting Jesus and learn to be obedient by the grace of God. What they do, they say, oh, I'm going to become the life of the party by drinking spiritus liquor. And the liquor is going to fix the problem that I have.
Yes.
And then it's the same thing. Peace.
That's correct.
Peace. Is it the true peace? It's a perception. Remember, everything the devil is doing is messing with your perception. Adam and Eve thought their eyes were open, but their eyes just got closed. Remember, sin causes us to be blind. Adam and Eve thought that they were experiencing something new, but what they were doing, experiencing failure. See, the person drinks the alcohol to get peace and love and joy. They're drinking that alcohol, but the alcohol is going to take away their peace. Because the things they're going to do is going to cause them to lose peace and ultimately even die. They go and run into a light post and go hug it real hard at 100 miles per hour. But it's the eventual is the problem. They didn't die today. So the person drink the beer and said, wait a minute, what's so wrong with this? What's so wrong with it? Nothing happened to me today. Actually, I feel good. I have a buzz. My eyes open. I experienced something new. But the end product of that new experience is death. But they don't die immediately. And that's the trick. So that's why when the devil said, you shall not surely die, or in the day you shall not surely die. And then I leave Ed. And they're like, what happened? Nothing happened.
I'm convinced.
Something changed in their body, but nothing really happened. So they say, well, what's the problem? So you can imagine a person that say, you tell a young man, leave Atlantic City alone. Stop, don't go do the gambling. And they go gamble, and they probably win some money. It's like, what's happened? Nothing wrong. They don't see themselves. Like, I remember I was at a nursing home with Tamara, visiting somebody, a rehab facility, and I met this guy, 85-year-old. And I said, so yeah, what are you here for? And he said, well, what happened? I was at Atlantic City and I was gambling. And I put my house on the blackjack or whatever. Whatever was left, because he had borrowed money in his house. And he said when they rolled the dice, he lost. And he didn't remember anything after that because he blanked out. And he was sitting on a stool, and he said, what happened to him? They told him he fell face down on the floor. He collapsed off the stool and dropped face down and slammed his face into the floor. And then somehow they take him from there and they brought him to the hospital, and then he was in the rehab because he had just lost his house at 85. And he said, this lady knew was going to take him in. At 85, you're homeless. But I guarantee if you told him 40 years before, say, leave that alone. He says, what could possibly go wrong? It's just a little fun I'm having. He couldn't see himself at 85, homeless, broke, no money. All his money was wasted on gambling. The house took the money. Because the end result of sin, a life of sin, doesn't come immediately. And that's what the Bible says. Because the punishment for sin doesn't come immediately, the sons of men are set in their ways. Can't get them out of the way. Because they say, it's not going to happen to me right now. I'm going to enjoy this thing and it's going to be okay. So here the person now, look, they try to get the end result, but they try to do wrong to get the good result. The Bible says you can live a life that is beautiful, but you need Jesus in your life. And the person said, I don't need that. As a matter of fact, I'm telling you this, this is not in any brilliance of mine. Somebody told me that one day. He said, Lloyd, you know, we're trying to get to the same place. You know, I go to the bar to get what you go to church to get. He knew it. He says, I go to the bar to get what you go to church to get. But the end result for him is a messed up life. Because alcohol will mess up your life. But it doesn't do it immediately the first drink. So look at this real quickly. It says here, long suffering. A person could beat a person with that drunk. And they'll be all right. They'll be cool. Have you ever seen that?
Yes.
Cool. I see people in fights and they'll be like, they're cool. And you're looking at them and thinking, man, you're blooded. What's wrong with you? You need to go to the hospital. They'll be like, no, I ain't feeling nothing. I'm numb. Long suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance is the last thing. Temperance is self-control. This is the where it falls off. It doesn't work. The person who have drug alcohol in their system is not have no temperance. No temperance. Because they have no self-control. But in their mind they have control. Because they're so sedated. It's remember, all of this the devil does is a perception of the good life. If you ask a person out there that's living the most worldly life and it's a very worldly person, they perceive that they're living a good life. But from the outside, you're looking at them and thinking they're a lost soul. The more worldly is the more foolish and lost the person is. But they perceive because they're under the delusion that it's good. And that's what the carnal mind does because it's a control. The person is an addict. And again, if you look at it, a person lives under a bridge. It's some of the most carnal people you're looking at. You know why they're living under the bridge? Because drugs or alcohol is their controlling factor. And they'll prefer to live under the bridge and thinking, you're the loser. You're the loser because you're living a clean life and they're the winner because they get up every day and they high and they never have to go to work. Poor you. You have to get up and go to work and live a sober life and take care of your family, but they're the winner because they can get up from the morning until the evening and they're high as a kite because they're living for the flesh. Because the flesh tells them that what happened, I feel good. Things are great. You're suffering. You're sad going to work. You have to have some responsibility. Oh, you're miserable, you have to get up in the morning. Look at them, I can't just sleep in, right underneath the bridge. And hopefully I don't die from because I got frozen under the bridge because it's so cold outside. But guess what happened? I'm a drunk, I'm gonna keep hitting that bottle because the perception in my mind is that I'm high. What more is life? Life is good. Have you ever heard people drunk as ever? Life is good. And you don't have to suffer every day. And that's the problem with the carnal mind because the carnality says if it feels good, you're okay. As long as you get that feel good and it's hard to tell people, like, say, not do this. And so this is the struggle there. And so when Christ comes to us, Christ says, look, you need to get yourself in order. I want you to be obedient. That's the only way to live. There's this commandment, it's spiritual. But something is wrong with us. We can't attain to spirituality because we only doing the same thing. Like I say, I started with this example of a prostitute. You go to a young man and say, get yourself a wife and settle down. I have one wife. And the young man say, but I can get a better experience from having prostitutes and hoes around me. Can you deny the fact that they can? Temporarily. Temporarily. And that's the problem. And if you said to them, you will die doing that. You're going to die of some disease. They're going to say, yeah, but not right now. I want to have one life to live, and I need to live it to the fullest. So you know what I can do? I can risk dying of that disease. But I'm going to live the life of 10 men in probably a few years. And you can't convince them otherwise. Because to them, I'm getting the results that I want. I'm happy. I'm happy. And that's where the problem is, because the person can say, I am happy. Every day I can get, if I have enough money, I can go and buy 5 women. What are you talking about? You're telling me to live a life with one woman? I can go there and be crazy. And how do you argue against that? Because the devil would be right, in a sense. The devil is saying, yeah, you can be like God. And you see these guys nowadays, they call themselves gods. Why do they call themselves God? You go to the many of these guys, secular guys in the city, you go to some of the Rastafari, and they say, God, you know how many kids I have? You know how many women I've been with? I'm a God. I'm worshipped. And you be like, you and the devil is on the same path. You agree with the devil, but you're a fool. Your life is misery. And you live your life in depression. That's why you need drugs and stuff to keep yourself happy. You can't be high in life because you live a messed up life. And all these kids, you have messed up their lives. These kids will have permanent, for the rest of their life, mental problem because you messed up their life. Because their curse was that you were their father. and you mess up all these women's life and all these kids' life, and your life is a curse. And they say, yeah, I know, more drugs, more alcohol, to soothe my mind because of my guilt for the wicked life I've lived. And the devil end up winning and destroy their lives. I've 14 kids, 14 different women. What a shame. But if you ask them and say, psh, but I have more fun than you. Because the carnal says, oh, you can be happy and never do the right thing. We close off here with these few thoughts. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, verse 3 and 4. So how do we break the spell of this carnal mind? Because it's a spell. The spell of this carnal attraction. It is a spell. When a person is under the spell, they're deluded. Because you know, how do you break a spell from somebody who's saying, but I want to be happy, and then they try to think and they say, look, I got happiness. And what you're saying there, Lord, is that it says, you're saying to me to be obedient for me to get happiness, but I can disobey and get happiness. And this is where the struggle is. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4 says, according as he, his divine power, had given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. So his divine power has given us all things. So remember, when we're created to be happy and live in heaven, that's what we call it, or the Eden, or bliss. So somehow you look around you. We all live in, before we find the Lord, in the carnal mindset, the carnal pursuit. Whatever make our skin feel good, our eyes feel good, our mouth feel good, we live by that. The more deep fried chicken, the more pork, we live by that. But the problem is that we don't get that happiness. You look around us, this place is a hell. People miserable. People, you know, every year more people on drugs. The more people go after, notice we have a trend right now going on in the world. The more people go after the flesh to satisfy the flesh, more disease. Syphilis is on the rise. Chlamydia is on the rise. Herpes is on the rise. AIDS, gonorrhea, all of them is on the rise. And they're all now more and more becoming drug resistant. Because the more people you're trying to say, I need more, is a more disease. So you look at it, it's not working, but you think about it, God had created us to be in bliss. So was God wrong or was God right? And the only answer to this is the Christian. Only a Christian can give a true answer to this that says, is the life of righteousness and living a Christian a happier life? Or is the life of living, trying to satisfy the carnal, a happy life? Remember, we're created to enjoy the scent and our taste and everything. But somehow, sin causes us to hurt ourselves trying to chase after happiness. You see people jumping off bridge, saying that they're doing jumping so they can go, ha, ha, and they land. And sometimes they go, ha, ha, boom, dead. And you say, the carnal mind is death. You will die a fool if you live a life of a fool, chasing on cheap thrills. So here the Bible says, unto us was given all things that pertain unto life and godliness. We got it in the first place, but we lose it through the knowledge of him that had called us to what? Glory and virtue. It is more glorious to be a Christian, and it's more virtuous. It's a beautiful life. Amen. It's a beautiful life. I ain't no jumping off no bridge to feel good. No amens? I hope you don't do it either. And if you do it, I'll come visit you in the hospital, or I'll come and cry at your funeral. I will cry.
You will cry because
it's so sad. Craziness. Verse 4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and what? Precious promises, that by these you might be partakers. Might, you're not guaranteed. If you want it, you can have it. Be partakers of the divine nature. Notice here, Adam and Eve wanted what? To be as God. They cheated and they lost it. Yep. We are called to be like God. Amen. And we can do it the right way, or we can follow the world and cheat, or we're going to end up dead and end up losing our salvation. That's the reality. So that we, by these, we might be partakers of what? The divine nature, having what? Escape the corruption that is in the world through what? Lust. The reason why the world is so corrupt is because of lust. It all goes back to lust. Adam and Eve lusted, or Eve lusted after being like God by cheating, and they end up putting us in a situation. We're not going to continue in her way of doing things and end up in a good place. As I say, it's only a crazy person that keep doing the same thing and expecting a different result. And by God's grace, this delusion, we get cured from it, and we're not crazy. We get sane. The world is corrupt. Look, there'll be wars next year, and there's probably wars this year. All of them are fighting over material possession. They're lusting after stuff. And they could say, oh, we're fighting terrorism. We're not fighting terrorism. We fight. If there's a terrorist, he's fighting over oil or diamond. All of this stuff is over lust. You know why you have to have burglar bars and alarms in your house? Because somebody lusts after something in your house, and they're willing to break in your house and kill you if necessary to get it. So you have to protect yourself. Sometimes you have to even arm yourself. And you're not arming yourself against the deers and the bears. It's against your fellow human beings who are lusting after stuff, and they're willing to do the wrong thing to get the right result, so to speak. And they'll never come. And sometimes they have to bag them and bury them. Because somebody decided that you ain't going to break in my house and take my stuff. I'm going to kill you. And that's life. I'm going to get a gun. I'm going to protect my property. Because you know that there's a bunch of lustful people lusting after what you have. That's the reality. And so the Bible says, you and I have escaped this type of corruption. This is what makes the world corrupt. And the moment Adam and Eve did this, all of us have fallen. And the only thing that breaks the cycle is in Jesus. Two more texts here. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. So how do we become spiritual? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12 says, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God. Now, remember, the spirit of the world is that spirit that makes us do anything to get happiness. Anything we want in this life, we can cheat. You want to get an A on a test? You don't have to get an A on a test by doing the right thing and studying and preparing yourself. You know, you can simply do this cheat. Get somebody to do the test for you. Get the professor to mark you off. And so somebody say, why is this young guy, this young girl, sometimes it's a young guy, sleeping with a professor? You know why? Because she's not sleeping with a professor because she loves the professor. Or she want to sleep with a professor. Sleeping with a professor because the professor is going to give her a hey. Or give him a hey sometimes, side. These things happen. And somebody say, but why is she doing that? Because she crazy? No, she's not crazy. She just wants an A. Or he wants an A. And he said, well, you know, the end result is the person wants some money. And they realize that I can cheat and lie and steal and I can get good results. So that's why the world is so corrupt. And until we break that spell and say, you know what, Ben, I'm going to do the right, amen, to get the good result. You want the spirit of the Lord inside of your life? There is a way to do it right and there's a way to do it wrong. The way to do it is to go find the Lord, amen? The false way to do is to go into a church with a bedlam of noise and people are going to start playing the drum. You even know these Pentecostal church or these praise and worship church, when it's time for you, the members to receive the spirit, the drummer start with a certain drum roll. I used to be able to remember it, but it's good, probably I forget it. But he start with a certain drum roll, and the moment they start, the Holy Spirit comes down on the people. People just start going crazy. So the drummer is controlling the spirit. It's a shame what's going on in these churches. So here it says, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in words which men wisdom teach it, but which the Holy Ghost teach it. Comparing spiritual things with spiritual things, right? We compare spiritual things. I'm going to deal with that right now. In a future study, I'm going to deal with this idea here of spiritual things with spiritual things. Because we want to get deeper into this, how we know, how we become spiritual. Because right now, the struggle in our society is just that people are carnal. You know, I sometimes say to people, look, it's not about racism, the problem, really, at the core. That's part of the problem. A lot of times, it's just simply about money. If I can grab you and enslave you to make me rich, I'll do it. Because what I want is to live in luxury. I want to have the finer things in life. And I'll kill, rob, steal people to do it. And so, because the carnal mind is driving this. So, which thing we speak and which thing we preach about. Verse 14 says, but the spiritual man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. For they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them because they are what? Spiritually discerned. You can't know them because of the focal point of life. All knowledge is just to make money and to be happy. And you don't think there's anything else to do with life. Then you can't understand spiritual things because spiritual things is like, Lord, what you're saying don't make no sense to me. You're telling me that I can't live life and steal, but I can steal and get the same result. You're carnal. Your focal point is just the results. But you're not looking down the road because what happened to Adam and Eve? Was it great? No. Did they get a new experience? Yes. What was the new experience? They watched or they didn't probably see it happening, but they see the, they had to bury the body of the of their son, Abel. And you get the result and say, you see this, you know, you gods. And you're going to see somebody hack somebody to death. That's your end result. You're disobedient. Because what Cain wanted a good result, but he didn't want to do the right thing. He wanted the blessings of the Lord, but he didn't want to do it the right way. So what Cain did, kill his brother, because his brother upset him. And now all of a sudden, Adam and Eve say, uh-oh, that's our mindset in our son. He's sick as a dog. This is the end result. So here verse 15 says, but he that is spiritual judgeth all things. Yet he himself is judge of no man. This makes absolute sense. Because again, when you're carnal, you're looking at life, law, everything from one point of view. But when you're spiritual, you're looking at life from a deeper point of view. The long view. It won't work. That's why it's always beautiful to watch a parent talking to a child, because the parent has been through a lot of beatdowns in life, and they have learned some tough lessons that they have learned from other people around them. And so they're telling a child, don't do this. And the child be like, I know more than you. And just always say, give a child until they're about 30 something, where life have beat them and beat them and beat them. And they say, oh, my parent was right. Oh, man. I could have saved myself a lot of headaches. Eat your spinach. Verse 16, for who had known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him, but we know the mind of the Lord. Last text here, Romans chapter 8, verse 1 through 4. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 through 4. So how do we become spiritual again? There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. We're seeking obedience. We're seeking to be connected with our God. We're seeking to understand, why is it the Lord will say the things he said and do the things he did? Why would the Lord say, don't do this? To a sinner, it's difficult to understand. Why does the Lord say, thou shalt not steal? Why? Why would he say it? Why the Lord say, so we're going to talk about it in the evening. Why the Lord says, don't have no other gods but the one God? Somebody say, well, you know, all roads lead to heaven. Have you heard people say that? They're going to hell with that thinking. It won't work. It won't work. God says it's only one way. Verse 2 says, for the law of the Spirit of life is Christ, in Christ Jesus, and made me free from the law of sin and death. Law of sin and death is just one law. The end result is going to always be death. Somebody said, Lord, but why have to do what God says for me to do? The reason why, because you can't create life, you can't sustain life, and you have no heaven to go to. You might have a hell to go to, but no heaven. You don't even have a hell to go to. You can't even go to hell if you want to go to hell. You know that? Think about that. We don't have nothing. What we have is to serve the Lord. Verse 3, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. So it was weak because the law said, thou shalt not steal. The person said, why? The flesh focuses, I want this result. And you're telling me, don't do this, because if I do this, I'll get this result. Why not? You go to a person who's an NFL player, or a person, not an NFL player, but a person who has a physical body and a mental mentality to become an NFL player. And you say, don't do it. And they're going to say, why? Because they can't see the long term. They don't see themselves at 38, can't remember, where they live. After they're taking all the hits in the head. So they're going to say to you, I can't see why I could become a multimillionaire. And look at me, son, I'm in the ghetto living. And you're telling me that I should go to school and just become an accountant or something? Use the same brain power to do something else in life. And they'll be like, I can't see it. I could take all the hits in my head, but I could be a millionaire. And look how many of them now said they regretted it. It's not worth it because now I'm in my 30s and I can't remember where I live. So here it says, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin what? In the flesh. So we can condemn sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after what? The Spirit. When we walk after the Spirit, the law can be fulfilled in our flesh. We can live a life where we testify that you can be happy, you can be successful, you can be high, you can enjoy life to its fullest, and you can live the best life, and you don't have to be disobedient. Amen. You can do the right thing and end up with the right result. Adam and Eve says you can do the wrong thing and end up with the wrong result, and they end up, or with the wrong thing and end up with the right result, and they end up getting the wrong results. We want to get the right results. We want to be able to have happy lives, happy homes, happy church, happy society. But the only way to do that is through obedience through Jesus Christ. And that's what the Bible says, the law is spiritual, but if I'm living life focused on just the flesh, I become irrational, and the end result is I lose the flesh. After a while, that food don't taste as good as it used to. After a while, the life is not as good as it used to, because what happened, I try to satisfy it, and I end up losing it. I'm going to read this quotation here, because I keep sharing this quotation with you. I'm just reading right here in the middle. And it says here, just as soon as the people of God are sealed in their forehead, it is not as any seal or mark that can be seen, but a settling into the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so they cannot be moved. Just as soon as God's people are sealed and prepared for the shaking, it will come. It will come. So we need to be settled into the truth, both intellectually and spiritually. So I'm focusing on the spiritual because we often know what it means to be intellectual, to understand truth and to have knowledge and understanding. But we need to understand what it is to be spiritual people. People who not just live for the plain here and now and what I feel. You know, you say to somebody, say, but the Bible says, and they say, oh no, I don't feel like that. I don't feel that's right. Spirit is not making me feel like I need to do the right thing. You need to live by the Bible. And we need to know that says if we want good results, we need to go and do the things that are going to get good results. If we want to live under a bridge or live a worthless life, we're going to do the things that satisfy the flesh, and the end result is we're going to be a mess. Is that the truth? Yes. So hopefully this has been intellectually, but also a spiritual pursuit. Amen? Amen? That's the intention. So we'll sing to close in 334, 334, and then we'll close on that. Thanks again for being with us here.
Let the congregation rise as we turn to our closing hymn, number 334. Number 334. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove, while the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind me closer still to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Let us pray at this time to close. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Your word gives us information in regards to our salvation. And this is important because we're on this earth for such a short time. And we ask the Heavenly Father that this time be taken advantage of to prepare us again for eternity. Dear Heavenly Father, let us not be deceived by the things that we were taught. Sometimes many things that we've been taught are wrong. We have to relearn again and unlearn the things that pertain to spirituality. We know, dear Lord, that your word is true, and we have to be careful. Many people, the Heavenly Father, will lead you astray, but dear Lord, we pray that thy Holy Spirit would lead us into all things that pertain to heaven. And we know, dear Lord, that the Holy Spirit leads us into what is sin. So let us not shy away from these things. Let us take an honest look at our lives and see if we are living according to thy word. If not, we have an opportunity to do so at this time, to commit ourselves and to walk faithfully in thy path. Dear Lord, we have an advantage now, for tomorrow is not promised to us. So let us at this time soften our hearts and minds to follow your way and your will. In Christ I pray. Amen. Amen.